Hello, I'm Johnny Cash. But seriously, my name's Jade Urich, and it's a pleasure to have you back on the Wildfire live stream, along with co-host
Nigel Johnson.
Johnson, John and Nigelson.
Nicholas Jansen here. We're back again. It's been a while.
Happy to have you here. Happy to be here. Happy December 1st. Little alternatives. Well, we like to start these little things off with a musical selection, a musical choice. You don't like the toque?
No. Makes me bald. No. Not that there's anything wrong.
Nothing wrong.
Cheers.
Well, shall we start them off with a little tune?
Sure.
3, 2. Oh, before we go live, we're actually going live with photographer Kevin Unger this evening, so very excited to welcome him to the live stream.
We are indeed.
Oh, I need your love, babe. Guess you know it's true. Hope you need my love, babe. Just like I need you. Nick?
Hold me, love me. Hold me, love me.
I ain't got nothing but love, babe. 8 days a week. Love you every day, girl. Always on my mind. One thing I can say, girl. Love you all the time. Nick?
Hold me, love me. Hold me, love me.
I ain't got nothing but love, girl. 8 days a week. 8 days a week.
I love you.
8 days a week is not enough to show I care. Ooh, I need your love, babe. Guess you know it's true. Hope you need my love, babe. Just like I need you. Hold me, love me. Hold me, love me. I ain't got nothing but love, babe.
8 days a week. Feels like we're on the eighth day of this week.
And it's only Wednesday?
Oh, it is Wednesday. I thought it was Thursday.
Welcome, everybody, to the Wildfire live stream.
This is a very special occasion. Not only is it December 1st, it is the first Wildfire standing stream.
We are going to be standing the whole time. So,
why?
Get used to it.
No reason.
I'm not actually this tall. I'm leaning.
That's more accurate.
Well, we're very excited to be going live with Kevin Unger, who is an internationally published portrait and advertising photographer based out of St. Catharines.
In college, Kevin discovered his knack for headshots and portrait work, which led to the start of his career in photography and digital media. Worked with some of the most recognized brands in the country like Warner Brothers Records, OVO Sound, Spotify, Compassion Canada, and Ronald McDonald House Charities.
Campaigns that feature his work have been used on billboards in Yonge and Dundas, across the city of Toronto, and in various magazines and books.
In 2016, Kevin was the recipient of the Entrepreneur of the Year Award from Niagara College, was named a Top 40 Under 40 nominee in both 2016 and 17, as well as Niagara Entrepreneur of the Year Awards nominee in 2017.
Nominee! In addition to his skill set, Kevin is an educator and brand builder. He has a passion for teaching his industry on how to shift from marketing to photographers and start marketing to clients. Shift from marketing to photographers and start marketing to clients.
Mm. He's also spearheaded workshops teaching other photographers about lighting, posing, and retouching.
Can't wait to dig on his work. Well, let's go live with Kevin Unger on Wildfire Live. Cheers, brother.
Cheers. Everybody drink some water.
Yo! What's going on? How are you?
I'm good, man. How are you?
That's a good question. Well, that's a good question. I'm good. It's happy Wednesday. We're here on a Wednesday night. Thank you for letting us take your time. I know you must be very busy right now and things are crazy. And
things are nuts, but it's good. It's all good things. It's all good things.
Nice.
It's good crazy.
It is a good crazy. Good crazy is all right.
Oh, yeah.
Nice, man.
Cool.
Well, I'm just curious, like, what has, I guess, as we come to the end of
this year, which has been 2021, a little different from 2020. I'm just curious about maybe a little bit about how your 2021 has been, but also kind of what you're looking forward to sort of transitioning to the next year as well.
Yeah, so this has been a big, it's been a good year. It's been busy. It's funny because it went from like what feels like not working at all to all of a sudden being packed. And we've been able to make a few hires this year, which has been great too. So we've hired a few people on, which has been awesome. Yeah, which has been really cool. It's been really, it's been a packed schedule, but very thankful for it all. And as we go into next year, I think that the biggest thing that like we're trying to transition is into just we're trying to grow a lot over the next little bit, and not just for growth's sake, but also because I think we're offering a pretty dang good product. We want more people to have it, and product and service, and want people to have that, and also we want to be able to serve more people. And it's cool we're able to get people jobs, and I find that really, really fun that we're able to provide jobs for people who want to be photographers or work in marketing or in editing, that kind of thing. And then it can be really hard to do on your own. It's possible, but it can be hard. So it's really cool for the people who maybe don't necessarily want to, that they can do that.
Right. Helping others find the money.
Yeah, it's fun. Yeah, dude, it's really fun. It's really fun.
I guess just to, like to start off, very like icebreaker cold in.
Yeah.
Where are you from?
Yeah, I'm from St. Catharines. I've been born and raised in St. Catharines my whole life and lived in Niagara like my whole life.
Same. Well, not my whole life, but born and raised. So what do your parents do? Were they involved in like creative arts growing up, or did you kind of find that on your own?
No, yeah. So neither of them are involved in that. But however, my dad does run his own business. So I think that's where it never made it weird for me to do my own thing. Because I had like teachers who had told me like, "Don't run your own business. It's not going to work. It's not going to be successful." But I'm like, I don't know. I was a really bad. I'm not a really bad. I just didn't, wasn't a great student. I'm a terrible employee. So I figured self-employed route was the only way it was going to work for me. So.
As a kid, and you had to, everybody had to go and do class photos, but also your individual photos. Were you like looking at what everything was going on at that point? Did you have an interest in it when you were like in elementary school?
I mean, okay, so here's how I got into photography. I actually remember very distinctly. So I remember in grade 8, we had an art project, and I got an A++, better than the one person in the class who's always the smartest. It's like, ha, I'm smarter than you, suck it. So and that got me interested in photography stuff. And yeah, throughout high school, then I ended up buying a camera for a family vacation or something like that. My parents helped me out, and I paid them back. And then from there, I wanted to go to band shows. For free, and then I told them, "Hey, if you can just get me in, I'll take your photos." And then, shockingly, it worked. And then, slowly but surely, I started charging $10 for photos plus entrance fee, then $20, and then I started doing their band promos, which was kind of cool. Yeah, and then from there, it led to some of the bands started getting in some magazines, and I started getting some stuff like cardboard cutouts in Japan. So I was like 16, 17, getting some stuff like published. I'm like, okay, cool, I can definitely do this whole photography thing. But I definitely need to figure out how to run a business. And so I went to school, college for marketing. And while I was in marketing, that's when sales and marketing at Niagara College. And
Nice.
when I was there, that's when I figured out, okay, cool. Like there's like headshots, and figure out how to do that. And then I also at the time I started a wedding company with two of my friends. And then we quickly closed it because then I got engaged and I was like, I'd rather work with my soon to be wife. And so we switched over to that. And then from there, that's kind of how Morning Light began, and then also for the commercial work has also grown. And then we changed it eventually from Kevin Unger Photography to we started to hire people on, like, hey, we don't need my full name on it, so I'll just change it to Unger Studios. So yeah, so that's kind of how I got started and how I got interested in photography stuff.
Obviously you form a partnership as a relationship romantically and personal relationship to grow and be best friends. What about being a business partner with your significant other, with your partner there? What has that I guess on both sides been like for you? Like, I guess from like, how does it affect the home life versus how the home life affects the business life too, I guess, right?
Yeah. So we work in different places.
Oh, okay.
No, so that helps. I work from the office. She works from home. But no, it's great. I mean, like obviously, like we probably if we're working together, we probably bicker more than me with somebody else. But it's because also you, it's like you're always the harshest with the people you love, right? So it's like we probably bicker more than maybe like working with another partner. But it's overall it's great, and we really love it.
Nice. I guess you can be honest. I guess that's the
Yeah,
key.
exactly. Yeah. Honest, but sometimes you may be a little too frustrated and you lose your cool a little bit, which maybe isn't always the right thing to do, but overall it's good. It's really good.
So you both do you both do the same thing, or do you do very different things in your company?
So we both shoot. And then Victoria was also, she just finished up school actually. So she did political science. I manage a lot of the day-to-day stuff right now just because she was in school and she just finished up. So just, figuring out what like the next little bit of life looks like. But I tend to manage most of the day-to-day stuff and also with people who work for us, like just making sure that they got everything they need. And if I need to help them in any way, how I'm doing my best to help them, and also shooting, emails, all that stuff.
Sure. It's a lot.
I guess going back to this this mythical camera for this vacation, what was this camera? And I guess what kind of stuff did you take initially, and how did that kind of get you going and your creative juices flowing?
Yeah, it was a Nikon D5000. I took photos, anything and everything, because I mean, I was just getting into it, right? And like, I think I like taking photos now, but I'm loving like the business side of things, which I find really fun. And it's business is just as creative as photography. And we just happen to be like, I'm doing it, this business in a creative industry, which is great. But yeah, so the first camera was a Nikon D5000, and yeah, I was taking pictures of lots of stuff, and then pictures of people, and I liked to take pictures of bands, that kind of thing.
Very nice. Yeah.
I guess, are there any photographers that you see out there right now, either on social media or not, that you kind of would like be like, that's a model of not just artistic success, but business success as well?
Yeah, 100%. Purple Tree, and I am a huge fan of them. Purple Tree.
I'm taking notes.
Purpletree.ca is their website. They are awesome people. I started doing, I reached out, and that's actually why I really like their, their business model too. I reached out to like one of the owners, and he ended up saying, yeah, let's grab coffee, and I've been doing some coaching stuff with him, and I just like basically said like, hey, I want to do, without copying you guys, I want to do what you guys have done. And so they've been great, and he's been very helpful, been open book, which has been great. And that's what I try to do. That's what I like. Yeah. So they are an awesome company. They are a fantastic company.
A little cross promotion. It's always good to shout out others that are doing the stuff we love to do.
They're fantastic. Great people.
That's awesome. I guess we've kind of covered the how did you get started question. And what was the first piece of gear you kind of came in contact with? But as a business owner, I mean, you have to cut costs, I'm sure. But is there a piece of gear out there that you'd love to spend a pretty penny on and purchase?
Yeah, I mean, probably the Canon 50L 1.2. I'm shooting Sigma stuff right now. And like, here's the thing. Everything I buy now, I have to buy 4 or 5 of them. So keep that in mind. So every piece of gear, so that 50L, yeah, it's $3,000, I think. It's like, okay, cool. You can splurge on that. But no, it's actually got to buy 4, 5, 6 of them for everyone. So that's when it gets expensive. Yo, you're buying one camera? No, you're buying 5. You're buying 6, like that kind of thing. So
that's mainly because you have, I mean, obviously everybody that you're delegating, but also you're managing this consistency of quality between all the shoots need to be the exact same.
Yeah, everyone's shooting the same gear because we don't ever want like a lack of consistency. So yeah, everyone shoots the same stuff.
Lenses too? Similar lenses too?
Same lenses, everything. Like it's literally like everyone basically has like the same kit.
Okay. And is there a particular lens that, or like what's the lens that everybody's using? We're just curious.
Yeah, Sigma 50, because it's affordable and it's great. It's like you're getting L series glass quality for like cheaper pricing. It's fantastic. I love it. And yeah, and shooting on the R6. So I have 2 R's, and then we have some R6s as well. But I think in the next year, I'll stop using the R and just get an R6. It's fantastic. It's so good.
Really? Yeah. Yeah. For video though, I mean, you also are in the video game as well. Are you using the same cameras used for photography for video?
Same stuff. Same gear. Because yeah, we're trying to use stuff that's like as versatile as possible, right? So this way we don't have to go and spend tons and tons of money unless we start doing video stuff like way, way, way more than maybe one day we'd go and invest in cinema stuff. But right now we're doing it enough that like we have great gear for it, but not enough where I'm like, I'm going to go and spend $15,000 on a cinema camera.
Well, I'm curious because like obviously as a photographer, you build your own style up. Have you had any, triumphs or failures in taking your photography style and adapting that to cinematography? Is there pretty well the same thing for you, or is it quite different? I'm just curious about that experience for you.
Yeah, well, I mean, I tried to launch a photo course for wedding photographers last year, and I lost a bunch of money. So that was a lot of videos. That was a big video course. I basically wrote like 45,000 words for between all the videos, and it tanked, and I lost a bunch of money. But it was good. So that was a failure. That was fun. Lost thousands of dollars doing that, but it's good. But that then got me into video stuff again. I was like, oh, okay, cool. And then I realized there's a really big need in the corporate world for video stuff. And also, if you're offering, let's say like you're doing some headshots for a company, like, hey, do you also need a promo video? Or like the other day recently, this one company I do work for, they needed some photos of their a couple people from their board of directors who were in the States that they couldn't get here last time. So, but they're like, hey, wait, do you also do video? And I was like, yeah, they needed a bunch of like little 20-second clips against a gray background, something nice and pretty simple. But we had like a good setup for it and everything like that. It's nicely lit. So I know how to light stuff well from photography, and that was easy to cross over because understanding lighting was really helpful. Make sure the audio is good. And then that then brought the average client value way up for jobs like that. Went from a couple headshots to headshots and video in the same day. So instead of being there for like, what, half an hour to do a couple headshots, it was then like a whole morning and then a whole morning thing. And that was then a bit much bigger job, which yeah helps you bring the average client value up, which then helps you run a more sustainable business.
Let's get into it.
There you go. Okay, so you start your own business way back, and you talked a little bit about how you would shoot for bands, and then I guess the transition between starting to like kind of monetize your skills versus kind of like doing favors for people, I guess, like at what stage did that become a factor for you?
I think, yeah, it was slow. It was a slow burn, right? So it was asking for the $10 to go to the show plus that, because you should have been like, oh, wow, this guy, you start proving yourself, right? Like, see, I think everyone's got to start at some point doing some stuff for free, but you start proving yourself and then people start going, okay, cool, we can trust this guy, because you're building trust and you're showing your value, right? And so once people can, you can start like showing that what you're doing is of value and it's going to help them there, then you could start to ask for some money. And then once people can see, okay, cool, that was money well spent, there was value behind that, then you can ask for more. And it's like, so I think it's a slow burn, or if you're a smart business person. Here's the thing. I think at the end of the day, we all run businesses with a learnable skill attached to it. Like, I run a business with a learnable skill, that being photography and video. So I think a business person could probably make money much quicker doing photography than I think a photographer does, and then starting to do business stuff after. But yeah, I think if you can learn the business side of things, I think that's probably going to be your best bet.
What are five things that are easy that if everyone could do, they could run a decent business?
Okay. Yeah. Okay. So first of all, systems and processes for literally everything. Use a good CRM, like a CRM, client relations management software. Like, we use Sprout Studio. We love Sprout Studio. They're also a client of ours, which is awesome. I'm stoked that they are and that we're able to do work from. That's just amazing. Sprout's awesome. So we use anything internal or anything that clients see is through Sprout. Anything internal, we use ClickUp. So that's really fun. So that's would be number one, get a good CRM and systems for everything. Number two is understand how to communicate. Everything at least in recent history was built with communication and words. And so if we understand how to communicate clearly, that'll help any business. It'll help you in business and relationships and all that stuff. So which then helps you also to, I guess maybe the next point within the good communication is have a good website. We don't buy the best products. We buy the ones we can understand the clearest. So make sure your website is clear, and also really focus on the client journey and making sure people have a really good experience with you. Because at the end of the day, every product, every service we offer is some sort of experience. And if people have a good experience with you, they're going to remember that. I read a really good book, Be Our Guest, by the CEO of Disney Parks. And yeah, it's all about just a client experience, and that has changed the game for us. Fifth, also remember, I read the book Infinite Game by Simon Sinek recently. Just the idea of like business is not a finite game. It's not a how quick, like, yeah, it's like it's a long game. It's like the whole point of an infinite game is just to keep it going. And that's business. Keep it going, which then means treating customers well. If you end up having employees, treating your employees well, paying people well, just being kind, honest, do things morally, ethically, all those things. So I think if you can do all those things, also get a bookkeeper, because holy crap, I'm bad at math. And that's well worth the money. So there's five or six. I don't know where we're at.
I think it's like seven.
Okay, cool.
That was good. I mean, you read a few books. You should write a book. But in all seriousness, that's awesome. So, I mean, you know, passionate about photography to start. Passion became, I guess, when did your passion for business start? Just for reference.
Yeah, probably when I went to school for sales and marketing. I started I got really interested in business and like marketing stuff. And then yeah, so it kind of just kind of grew from there.
Okay, so what part about the two-part question? What part about the craft do you enjoy the most? And then what part about the business marketing sales part of it do you enjoy the most?
Yeah, okay, so part of the craft. Honestly, it's working with people. I'm like super extroverted, so I love just being around people and working with people. And when it comes to the business side of things, it's probably also working with people, like whether it's employees, because like we're hiring people and getting to like I don't care about me being the face of things or like being the best. I don't care. I'd rather see people who work for us become better and just like being able to help them and seeing the stuff that they're doing. It's like it's really cool. Like we the other day were talking at this one event, and I handed part of it over to Tanis, who's our client relations manager, and she was talking about stuff. I'm like, I had no part in, with a part of our sales process. I'm like, I had zero part in that, and she owned it, and it's actually doing really well. And I'm like, this is awesome to see someone else who's like learned some stuff and now done really good. So yeah, I think just like working with people from a business standpoint is one of my most favorite things right now.
Nice. What resources would you recommend to first-time photographers, I guess, to get a better understanding of lighting their subjects properly or better?
Go study a lot of photographers. Like go look at like Joey L, who's like a studio photographer. Go look at Jose Villa, who's a film wedding photographer. Go look at Annie Leibovitz is great, but she's great. There's a bunch. Jeremy Cowart, he's like an artist. He's like turned into more of a fine artist. He's dope. He's really good. But then also go look at like graphic design stuff. Go look at the inspiration, all these different spots. Break down lighting, go break down poses, write it out. I think physically writing it out will help you a ton.
I'm curious, obviously we're kind of keeping the conversation geared toward, you know, photography and business, but and video, but I'm curious, like, do you have, any chips to play in, becoming like an ad producer or creative director of that sort?
Not right now. I've never really even thought of that, to be honest with you. I'm like, okay. I know kind of where we're going with like morning light stuff, and that's I'm like kind of where we're in Unger Studio stuff, so we're pushing that. But
right.
The other stuff, maybe one day, who knows?
Like the whole ideation life, right? Where it's people throwing stuff against a board. I mean, basically one of these. I mean, kind of thing.
Yeah.
But then building from that way out. I mean, whatever you have before you take on anything else, you bring that to where it is as well, right? I guess just we were talking about lighting subjects to the post end. As far as editing and that way that pipeline workflow works for you, what types of software do you typically rely upon? What is that workflow like for you? Is it
something you offer? So for weddings, basically when we get the photos, we call sort the wedding in Lightroom, and then we also edit it all in Lightroom too. We use the archetype process profiles, and like honestly, we apply them and just make it a little bit brighter. Like we really don't do that much with our stuff because we just try to be really tight. This way, we can minimize as much editing time as possible. As for commercial work, we're starting to use Capture One more. Which I really like because I find it's like Photoshop level coloring, but like Lightroom level workflow. I really like that. So we're starting to use that more. And then Photoshop for retouching, anything like that.
Right, right. I guess a little bit of tales from the photographer, a little bit of behind the scenes story, if we can get into one. What has been one of the most difficult shoots or shots that you've had to get? What was that like?
That's a good question. I don't know about difficult. I don't know. I haven't really given that much thought, but I know definitely stuff that a lot of stuff like in like the wedding world has been really, really cool because there's been in really impactful moments of like this one I didn't even like the one that actually comes to mind I didn't even take. It was Beth who worked with us. She this photo of like the groom and his mother doing the first dance at the wedding, and the bride just bawling in the background, and his mom was terminally ill with cancer. It's like, dang, man, like, that's, like, yeah, like, that's, That's hard.
Yeah.
So I'm like, I'm sure we probably had moments like that, but that's the only one I can think of, and I didn't even shoot that, so I'm not sure. I have a pretty short memory.
That's all right. That's a pretty good answer.
Yeah.
So I guess like last couple of years have put everything, all of us through the ringer. What about the work inspires and drives you to continue and move forward?
Well, I think first of all, and maybe this is silly, but I don't know. I've been of the opinion like there's been a lot of unfair things, like how like the government shuts people down or certain sectors of photography and video can work, a certain can't. It's like, it makes no sense on that end. Sure. But like, I don't know, part of this, like, I don't know who promised you when you're starting a business that this is going to be easy. That was never part of the deal. So I'm like, whatever, as long as we can figure it out and pay our mortgage every month, that's cool. But yeah, what inspires me, I think it's, at this point, I'm like, I am loving having people on our team. I think that's so much fun. And we've got a pretty good idea of where we want to go over the next 3 years, 3 to 5 years. So it's just pushing towards that and just trying to provide an awesome place to work. And yeah, that's our goal right now.
That's awesome. In regards to, I think, you know, the whole sort of role of the leader and the I guess just the part you play as a leader of your company, how do you inspire people and how do you get the best performances out of them and lead? Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Getting best performance out of them. I'm like, just be kind to people, hire people who are competent. And be nice to them, pay them well, be there for them if they need stuff and help them, like give them all the resources they need to succeed. I don't know. I think if you're trying to maximize people, I think you can start getting into a very finite mindset of like, how do I maximize this? How do I squeeze the juice out of this? No, that's not the goal. We want people to be here as long as possible. So like, yeah, it's going to be a process. You're getting better at your job and that's fine. We'll figure that out along the way. We're looking for people who are really great, the personality is great. They have good work ethic because you can teach a skill. That's easy. But like trying to squeeze the juice and make people as productive as possible. Yeah, we want to be efficient, but like, just, yeah, we want to have people for the long haul. And that's what we're trying to look for.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
Go work for Unger Studios.
So the competitive nature of your industry, and as it relates to other industries as well, what's the nature of defining your own path and finding yourself along the way?
Well, I think there's more than enough work to go around for everyone. So, is it competitive? Maybe. Sure, I guess. But there's enough work for everyone. Like, dude, like even just in the wedding industry alone, there's gotta be at least 5,000 weddings in Niagara a year. And that's not including like any religious weddings that take place with like churches, like whether Christian, Muslim, Jewish, like, cause I was just like thinking about officiants that I know and how many they've said they've done. I'm like, and those would be like typically non-religious weddings. Cause most religions will have like their pastor or whatever marry them. So it's like, there's gotta be at least like 5,000 weddings in here. So there's so much work for everyone. And it's funny, like, I think like, I don't know, like one of the presidents, the old, like that's now long gone. It was just, I'm like, oh no, it was Henry Ford. Sorry. He's like, whether you think you can or think you can't, you're right. So it's like, I don't know, if you think you can start a business and you'll figure out a way, like, yeah. But I think like just being able to be like abundance mindset, having that mindset of abundance, I think that'll pay dividends long term.
Yeah. And I guess shifting your strategy and shifting your, the way that you communicate your brand, over time as well. Like one of the things that we picked up on was instead of marketing to photographers, you're marketing to your clients instead. So I guess what are some of those, if you were to do a Venn diagram, some things that kind of fall in the middle, but then are sort of only photographer centric, only client centric, and how do you kind of keep them apart or I guess bring them together sometimes?
Okay. So I don't want to market to photographers at all. Unless they're our client, they want to be our clients. But we're not like, but it's more, if they are, it's more of like, they've seen what we do and they want us to do what we do for them. And yes, whether it's like with some web stuff or video or photo stuff, or even just like marketing, helping clarify their message. I think the whole point of business, like businesses exist fundamentally to just solve problems. So just make sure you're solving people's problems. And like, so if you know you're in the corporate world case, you're helping people have like better corporate photos or whatever. You're in the wedding world, you're helping alleviate the stress of finding a photographer, the overwhelm, that kind of thing. So just like figure out what your clients' problems are, what are their pain points, and then talking about that to them. And I think if you're doing that, you don't need to worry about what other photographers are like marketing photographers, that kind of thing. So I'm like, I don't think photographers don't pay you, clients do.
That's interesting because I feel like a lot of social media that has been ingrained in me over the years, and I feel like maybe I'm being corrected now that I'm wrong, is to be like, to market to the thing that you do. But no, it's not that at all. It's the, you have to really figure out the question and the need and go to those people and find those audiences, which is not always easy, I don't think, because influencers within your whatever profession or craft that you do are easy to find.
Yeah. Oh, totally. Well, I think it's, yeah, it's, you know, like, hey, if you want to shoot like corporate video, then go like talk to, like, I mean, like, you know, even like talking to past clients is really helpful. Like, that's what, like we're doing a lot with like the wedding stuff right now. We're going and we have good phone calls, and we don't say bad ones. We said we have phone calls where we learn a lot. Because inevitably some clients aren't going to like you, or they didn't like their experience, or there was aspects of the experience they did not like, and that's okay. Because we're going to figure out what that was, and then we can figure out that, and then like what they liked, what they didn't like, what they had trouble with, what they found when they were wedding planning and looking for photographers and checking in at different points, and then you can start using that to write your website copy, to write your follow-ups for leads, that kind of thing. So I think, yeah, like if you just talk to past clients, like, because I'm like or even people you want to work with, and figure out, hey, what are you, like, if you wanted to go into the corporate photo or video side, go talk to companies that would be like, you think maybe your ideal thing, and ask someone in the company, if you can grab content, like, hey, what are you struggling with content wise, or what can I help you? Like, and just try to figure out like what you can help with, or what they're lacking. Is it social media management? Okay, cool. Or why, what about it? Okay. Is it overwhelming? Okay, cool. So you clearly it's overwhelming. So all of a sudden you can be like, or booking a photographer is overwhelming. And you can even have like in your head, your header, like taking the overwhelm out of booking corporate photos or whatever, you know what I mean? Like, that kind of thing. And so when you can start appealing to that, because it's like, I don't know, there's people say there's B2C and B2B, but what book was it? Never Lose a Customer Again by Joey Coleman is big on, it's like H2H, human to human, right? Like we interact with people and people have feelings, they have overwhelm, they have stress, all that things. And like, how do we then like help alleviate stress? How do we make their day better? How do we make them the hero of the story? Because we're the guide, they're the hero.
That's a good one. We have some sort of fun wildfire themed questions to go into. So if you could do any other profession rather than your own, what one would you like to attempt?
Probably just work in marketing. That'd probably be it. Or I was actually thinking about this. Maybe one day take over, I mean, I doubt it would happen, but take over my dad's construction business. Cause I think there's many industries that are very outdated that I think are ripe for people to do things differently. And I think that's one of them. So, and I think that, yeah, you can do very well in construction, because I think it's very outdated.
If you lived in a separate time, say the 11 or 1200s, would you see yourself as a portrait painter?
No, not at all. I'm not good at painting at all.
That's a good hypothetical.
Yeah, not bad.
How have you found ways to travel with your job, or has there been any opportunities afforded to you to travel with photography?
Yeah, we've gotten a couple destination requests. We've not turned them down, but I think most people think that as soon as you are going there, well, it's a vacation. What do you mean? You don't need to get paid. We're like, nah, like that's part of it. Right. So we don't travel a whole lot. I mean, like just like Ontario mainly.
Right.
Because there's so much work in Niagara region, so it's great.
Transitioning over naturally to social media and the role it plays in getting your art and business out there and using for a showcase for skills. What have been some of, I guess, your, your ups and downs of the social media landscape? And I mean, you've been consistently, you know, using it as of we, so I'm just curious about, I guess, some of your short-term and long-term strategies in building up a brand on social media.
Yeah, I think in terms of like the account that I'm currently talking from, I've really crapped the bed on that. It's not great. But I think the goal should be to just solve people's problems and provide value to people. I think as long as you're doing things that provide value, it's like, okay, well, for example, so for Morning Light, what we do is we have blog posts, and then we use those blog posts. We then obviously as a blog post, and then also then break down each paragraph or section into multiple like mini things for Instagram. And then one blog post becomes like 5 or 10 Instagram posts. And then we also then use that blog post as a script, then make a video out of it and then put it on YouTube and also as the blog too, because this way then more people will watch a video than actually read text. But then the text also on the blog post helps with SEO, that kind of stuff. So that tends to be our strategy in terms for social media stuff. But it's all based around what we find people are looking for, the problems they're having. And we also test different things too and try to sort of see like on search volume, like of like what people are searching, that kind of thing.
Right. And picking your marketing side of your brain, what platform do you think is best for as far as marketing?
Figure out where your clients are at and then choose. Mm-hmm. I think Pinterest is wildly underrated. I think if you're in the corporate world, oh my gosh, go to LinkedIn. If I find I'm not joking, almost probably every other time, like I post something valuable, like if you're posting crap, then it's no one wants to watch that or look at that. But like every time I post something that I believe is relatively valuable, or every other time, get an inquiry. It's nuts because people want value. And if you can show people how you're going to, if you can help them, give them quick tips, figure out what they need and providing answers to those questions or helping them overcome the problem that they're having, you'll be fine.
Have you used any of the LinkedIn learning resources?
No, never. Are they good?
I don't know. I just got into the union for filmmaking as a production coordinator, and that was one of our perks. Was like LinkedIn Learning is included.
Oh, that's cool. That's awesome. No, I've never tried it before.
Yeah,
man, I'm sure it's going to be at least decent.
I'll let you know. Maybe if there's some photography stuff, I'll let you use my subscription.
Sounds good.
I mean, as far as social media goes, I mean, Nick has like been doing TikTok now for about a year and a half, 2 years, consistently posting, built up quite a few followers.
Give me a minute.
Viral little hits, and I've been doing the social media game on Instagram mostly, a little bit on Facebook and Twitter and stuff. But it's difficult to make successful social media content. It's funny what works and what doesn't, and what sticks on the wall, and what trends people are digging versus we just come up with something different, and it's like, oh, that wasn't the trend, but that's cool. People are into that.
Yeah, we don't really pay attention to trends. We just try to post like what we think is going to be valuable. People, I like because trends come and go, so I'm like, eh. I'd rather keep trying to, yeah. And like a lot of people tell us like, hey, I really liked how like you guys had a lot of blog posts. That was really helpful. You really helped me. And the whole goal is especially for getting customers. We want that, make the people think as little as possible. Like just give them everything they need so they don't have to think. Cause if the brain has to burn too many calories, people leave. And I think too many people try to do that and try to be like, well, it should be obvious, or they try to make them jump through all these hoops. No, make it as easy as possible for people to do business with you, to understand. So people want to be entertained and they want or learn something. They want something of value.
Right. And they want it relatively easily digestible. Give it to me. Don't make me work too much for it.
Yeah, exactly.
I'll throw this one over to somebody from Niagara. I'm from Northern Ontario. So
what does it mean for you to come from Niagara and continue to rep it and kind of grow your business there?
I mean, yeah, it's cool. I mean, I haven't thought too much of like where we're from. We're more just focused on, hey, here's some things we want to do and let's keep trying to do them. But yeah, it's really cool. Like I always thought maybe I'd have to move over to Toronto, but there's so much work in Niagara. We're able to build a team in Niagara. And I think that's actually the really exciting thing is for what we're trying to do. We haven't seen a whole lot of people actually do that. There's been a couple companies that have done it, but like we're just, I think, trying to take a slightly different approach to it, which is really cool that we're able to do that. And yeah, so hopefully, I mean, it all seems to be working out so far. So yeah, it's cool that we're in an area that allows us to have a lot of work.
That's cool. Shout out to the Niagara region. It's where we all met. It's where we all met.
There you go.
Content creation. Looking ahead, where do you see yourself in the next 6 months? Next year? Next 5 years?
Okay, 6 months. We're trying to get all of our systems in place for weddings, and then taking that then like whole system, which we're working on right now and redoing a lot of stuff, for that whole workflow from the beginning and the initial like lead phase. We're kind of have like the whole pre-booking stuff done now, then going through like the whole wedding, the duration of them being a client for their wedding, getting that done, the whole system of everything we need to do for that, and then moving it over to family sessions, and then maybe changing some of our product offerings for family sessions. I'll be creating a lot of content for that. And we try to create content really intentionally, seeing like where are the pain points, where are the gaps, looking at our analytics, seeing where people are falling off and creating the content for that. And then once that's done, then we'll move over to like Unger Studios and start just like do that whole process over again. But we kind of have like the system by like starting to be like, okay, we're starting to know what we need to do, and like have, and that we're saying like nothing should be in our heads, everything should be written down. This way it's we have it there, because if someone gets sick or we hire someone new to do that job as well, they need to know how to do it. So that's what we're focusing a lot of our time on, and like creating the content for that. In 3 years, I think we're probably gonna that'll be 2025. We'll probably, our goal is to have probably 10 people, 10 photographers working for us. We're at three or four right now.
So like one a year.
Yeah.
I'm bad at math.
In this somewhat chaotic landscape and kind of high speed nature of your job and your profession, how do you prioritize supporting others and fostering those healthy collaborations, both in the people you work with as like employee, employer, and client photographer kind of relationship as well?
So employees first, because if employees don't feel good, clients don't feel good. I mean, like my job is to help them in whatever way they need. So that's number one. Making sure, and that's literally like, for example, Tannis, who works with us, who's awesome, the client relations manager, her whole job is just making sure that people are having a good time, and people, if they need anything, we're there to do stuff, and also checking in, like, if they were struggling with something and we were able to change it, just let them know, like we changed that right away. We worked on that right away. So I think, yeah, it's like making sure that like, here's the thing, like if we don't take care of our clients, we don't have jobs. So making sure that they're taken care of is also a huge priority too. So,
well, I mean, that about sums it up for us. I think at this point in the live stream, we like to give our guests the opportunity to do shout outs. And as well, like feel free to, you know, have the floor and any other information about your Unger Studios, your employees, or like anything that you want to sort of, you know, throw out there as far as positive energy goes. Mm-hmm. We throw the ball to you, my man.
Yeah, cool. Well, no, thanks, man. Yeah, I really appreciate you guys having me on. And yeah, it's been really fun. And I think, yeah, if people can do anything with their business or take anything away, it's like, I think it's remembering that business is not a finite game. Finite games are like basketball or hockey. You know the team at the end of the game with the most points wins. But business is not like that. If your competitor goes out of business, you did not win business, because it keeps going. And that's the whole goal of this game. And I think if your goal is to be a working creative for a long time, think about being in it for the long haul and what you have to do to be in it for the long haul, if that's your goal. Just try to have a more infinite mindset, I think is going to be really helpful and help a lot of people, because that'll help you serve your clients better, serve employees better, if you end up being able to work with employees. And it's, yeah, so we're just really thankful for everything that's happened.
Wow. Thank you. I feel like we learned a lot in this short time. I mean, we were taking notes.
We took notes.
Asked a lot of the questions wanted, so, and you were very generous with your answers, so thank you, man.
Yeah, oh, anytime. If you guys ever have questions, don't hesitate to ask. I'm an open book, so just reach out.
I'm looking forward to the book. I'll buy the book as soon as it's out.
Sounds good.
In all your free time, you can get that ready. Yeah.
Totally.
All right.
Well, I guess...
have a wonderful rest of your evening, and thank you for joining the Wildfire live stream, my man.
Yeah, thanks, guys. Thanks so much for having me.
Thanks.
Absolutely. It was a pleasure.
Okay, see you guys.
All the best to you and your family and your employees.
Thanks, man. Okay, have a good day. Bye.
Thanks.
Bye. Well, that was a really nice live stream with Kevin Unger. Yeah, thank you for joining.
Oh, thanks.
Oh, what about this one? You got that one. Oh, you got this one.
Oh,
you got
that one. Well, this was actually, I think standing made it feel faster.
Well, it's good to be back. Not for too many more, though.
My legs are wobbly. What? But yes, as we wind down for the year, we have two more live streams currently planned for 2021, and then... nothing concrete after that, but nope. It's been an honor and a privilege to join you once again for a live stream.
Look, I'm not a hipster.
It's a fraud.
I'm a fraud.
All right. Well, thanks again to Kevin.
Let's go live the vida loca.
Oh, you look good. Oh, he's got to go sing in a cocktail lounge.
I learned salsa while I was in Mexico.
Oh, God.